Hello and welcome back to this e-learning course on using digital skills in the classroom. This is module 5, which is all about how to use social media. And in the last part of this module, we're going to be taking a look at some challenges around internet safety and responsible use within the context of social media. Now, when we look at the term internet safety and responsible use, it's really, really important to emphasise that the key part of this term here is really responsible use. And that's a big challenge for us in schools, because we always face the challenge of, do we lock and block a service down, or do we keep that service open and work with children and young people to educate them how to use it responsibly? Now, I'm a big favour in terms of the latter, because let's face it, we're teachers, our job is to educate young people. And the important thing, I think, within schools across Europe is that we don't ignore the problem. A great example of this is mobile phones in the classroom. Let's face it, lots of schools still ban mobile phones, yet they're powerful learning devices. The reason that mobile phones are often banned is not because they're a distraction and not because they're not good for learning. It's because the teachers that want them banned normally suffer from poor classroom management techniques. It's important that we work with those weaker teachers to teach them about 21st century pedagogy, so they're comfortable about using not just mobile phones, but all forms of technology in the classroom. If you want to find out a little bit more about this type of emerging practice, I suggest that you read the Cloud Learn report from Heppel.net and the Nominet Trust. It talks a little bit around effective practice in schools moving to the end of locking and blocking in the classroom. It gives examples of using Facebook, using Twitter, and using YouTube. Again, some of these services are still blocked in some European schools. If we're talking about internet safety and responsible use, it's really important that we understand the language that young people across Europe are speaking about. There's lots of different examples for this, but my favourite example is this picture. If I asked you to look at this picture and said to you, "What is this a picture of?" I can guarantee that lots of you are thinking, this is a picture of a digital camera. Yet, if I asked a group of 6 or 7 year olds, what is this picture of? I can guarantee that most of them would say, this is a picture of a camera. There's a subtle difference, isn't there? Digital camera, camera. It's because the young people have only ever grown up with the digital technology. They don't remember the traditional cameras where you had to load film, take film out, and take them to a shop to get them developed. The same principles could be applied to the word friend from a social networking site. To me, a friend is somebody that I know, somebody that I trust, somebody that I would be happy sharing some of my intimate secrets with. To a young person, a friend is just a connection on a social networking site. It's important that we work with young people to help them actually understand what a friend is within different contexts. Privacy is another important word that we need to consider when we talk about understanding a common language. There are lots and lots of reports that suggest that young people are more concerned about privacy than ever before. However, in my own research, when I ask a young person if they're concerned about privacy, they'll say yes. But if I ask them what privacy is, they'll struggle to define it. Again, they're giving us the answers that we want to hear rather than really understanding the actual matter. The challenge is, within European law, is it's almost impossible to keep up to date with the technology and the emerging technology. For example, across Europe, we've got lots and lots of laws that protect our privacy when it comes to closed-circuit TV cameras or security cameras. However, there are practically no laws that protect us against high streaming webcams, which, let's face it, is pretty much a form of closed circuit TV. You can go online and you can download apps and you can access webcams all around the world, which arguably, you know, are a breach of our privacy, but there are no laws that protect us. The biggest breach of our privacy is, of course, social media sites, where we choose, as adults and young people, to give away information. One interesting activity to try is to try Googling yourself, or even trying Googling me. As you'll know from Module 2, if you put your name within speech marks, it will give you a definite search of both your first name and your surname. You might be surprised at what comes up, particularly if you're into digital technology, right, and particularly if you're interested in this field. There might be things that come up from the digital news. It might, for example, reveal your phone number or your address in some kind of online phone directory. Or you may even be able to access national records from your country if they've been put online and if they've been digitised and if you've given permission for them to be accessed. Quite often, we don't even realise that we've given permission for our personal information to be accessed. We talked a lot about search engines in Module 2. One search engine called Pipple is a people search engine. Within Pipple, you can use your email address, a username or a phone number to cross-reference other social networking sites to find out information about a specific person rather than a product or service. So as I say, we quite often choose to give information away via social networking sites or other data that people might already have on us. It's important as well to remember that for many social networking sites, you have to be over the age of 13. This is because of a United States of America law, which is called COPPA. COPPA stands for Children's Online Privacy Protection Act. It doesn't mean that children under the age of 13 can't use social media sites. That's really important. What it means is that they can't register to be part of a social media site. So, for example, there's legally a big difference between uploading a video to YouTube, where you would be required to be over the age of 13, and watching a video on YouTube where anybody could watch it. So COPPA, as I mentioned, is a US privacy law. Now, social media sites are starting to get better and better about helping us protect our privacy. And you can normally find this in the privacy setting, in the privacy settings within that social media site. One of the things that I would suggest that you do with your students is to explore what the privacy settings mean on popular social media sites. Because the challenge that we've got, of course, is that many of these privacy guidelines are written for people over the age of 13, and therefore they're written in a language which requires you to have the literacy of a 13-year-old or above. If you were reading that information as a 5 or 6-year-old, you might not understand it, or indeed you might not even be able to read it. As well as understanding privacy, it's really important that we get across to children and young people this concept of a digital footprint. And that's this idea that no matter where you go on the web, it's almost impossible to delete anything from the internet. It's going to be stored on a server somewhere, and that means that it might be possible to be retrieved in the future. Now, don't get me wrong. I showed you this clip in the last video. If you say the wrong thing on a social networking site, then that might lead in a certain amount of repercussions. For example, losing your job for calling your job or your boss boring. But if you say the right things on social networking sites, then that might actually help you get a job. And again, I've used already the example of a journalist or an artist or a games designer who, in the 21st century, will be required to have digital portfolios. It's important to remember, though, as responsible adults, we need to make sure that we empower young people to be responsible for their own digital footprint. Some of this research here from the internet security firm AVG is therefore actually quite scary, because this is talking about young people under the age of 2 who are already starting to develop social networking profiles and digital footprints through no fault of their own, but because parents and family members are uploading content about them. Now, I'm not saying that this is a bad thing, but what I am saying is this will be the first generation of young people who will be impacted by this in 10, 20, 30 years' time. And it's important that we have a little think about what the repercussions of this might be. Do you remember the Wayback Machine from Module 2 when we looked at some of the hidden gems? Well, in Module 2, we looked at how you could go back and you could recall a website from the past. This is a really, really good service to revisit with children and young people to prove that it's almost impossible to delete anything from the internet. If you've forgotten about this, go back and have a quick look at that Module 2 video and use that in your teaching resource for teaching about internet safety and responsible use. So finally, what's the solution to this? Well, I'm a big fan of the quote from Cliff Dennett, who is a games designer, and he says the solution is always in the problem. So if the problem is children using social media irresponsibly, perhaps the solution is in young people using social media responsibly. And again, we've got a lot of great resources across Europe that can help us do that. InSafe, which is about the Safer Internet Forum, Safer Internet Forum and other Safer Internet centres across Europe provide a lot of great resources and support in local languages to be teaching about internet safety and responsible use. We can also see a number of internet and crime enforcement agencies starting to gain a presence on social media where young people are able to get support. CEOP, a Child Exploitation Online Protection Agency in the UK, you know, is a great example of that. And of course, social media sites themselves are starting to develop user-friendly, robust ways for you to be able to seek support in terms of what you need to do, such as the Facebook Family Centre and the Google Family Centre. And also, of course, when we think about internet-connected devices, let's not forget games consoles and let's not forget mobile phones. Because what we know from research over the UK is more and more young people are connecting to the internet and behaving socially using phones and games consoles than they are traditional desktop computers. So, lots and lots of good information there. The key point that I want you to take away from this video is that social media is not bad. The important thing is when we're talking about using social media in schools or social media in the workplace is that it's got to be about responsible use. And that's working with young people and employers to use these tools and services in a responsible way. Well, that's the end of Module 5. The next module, Module 6, is all going to be about a personal project. And there'll be a little introduction video for you to visit there, but there won't be a lot of me talking, you're probably pleased to know. I hope you have enjoyed that series on using social media in schools. Don't forget to check out the Social Media in Learning and Education project, the SMILE project, if you want to find out more about the subject area. I'll see you next week in the next module. Thanks very much.